Hello and welcome to week two of our adult small groups. Today we're going to be looking at the gospel for this coming Sunday, which is in Matthew chapter 22, beginning at verse 34. Before we start, you want to have that page marked. Also, please mark Deuteronomy chapter 6 and Leviticus chapter 19. If you don't already have those marked, pause the video for just a moment and do that. Otherwise, let's go ahead and look. And we start, before we go into today's gospel reading, let's just look at where we've come in the gospel. So Jesus, of course, had his teaching ministry when he was in Galilee. He was gathering crowds and gathering disciples and forming those disciples. And then in chapter 21, he got to Jerusalem. And that was Palm Sunday, the beginning of chapter 21. And things are different now while he is in Jerusalem. And this is going to make a difference in today's gospel passage. You know, when you're in a small town, for the most part, people tend to think, to speak, to act in a pretty homogenous sort of way, especially back in Jesus' time when there was no mass media, when you didn't have some people listening to CNN and some people listening to Fox News. Everybody got their news from the same place, the same gossip mill. And so everybody had pretty much the same opinions. And so it was pretty easy for Jesus to speak to everyone because they all had a pretty similar background. But now we're in the city of Jerusalem. And in the city, you've got people with lots of different backgrounds. You have immigrants who have come and gone, and people who are traveling, and people who engage in all kinds of different businesses. And especially in the religious community and the religious leadership, you have a lot of different opinions. And that's the environment that Jesus is in now. Also here in Jerusalem, you have the temple. And so you have the Jewish religious authority all kind of gathered and centralized here in Jerusalem. And so over the last few weeks in the Sunday Gospels, last week in our adult small groups, we've seen how Jesus is confronting them and really confronting the authorities. And he's doing so, and this is important to realize, he's doing so not just to, you know, not just to reject them, but it's a warning and it's an invitation. He wants them to receive the gospel message. He wants to bring them on board, but we're going to see over and over again that they don't do that. And so we've had parable after parable where Jesus is warning them, is letting them know that their position is not guaranteed, that the authority that has been given to them is about to be taken away. And they then respond by testing him, by trying to find ways to entrap him, just like we heard last week with the question about paying taxes to the emperor. And today, they're going to pose their last challenge to Jesus. This is their last attempt to try to trap him up and to get him dismissed by the crowds or maybe even have some other kinds of consequences done to him without their happening to intervene. And so we want to just keep in mind that's kind of the situation, that's the audience, you know, this is the Pharisees, but there's also the people from Jerusalem. As we look at it, as we look at the passage, it says in verse 34, when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a scholar of the law, tested him. So the primary audience now is the Pharisees. And so we need to understand what the Pharisees believed about the law. The Pharisees, they looked at what was going on in Judea. And from the time of the Babylonian captivity, when they were set free from Babylon, you know, they were able to go back home, but they weren't really free or they weren't independent. They were still under the control of Persia at that time. Later on, it was the Seleucids. At the time of Jesus, it's the Romans. But they're under one occupier after another. One nation conquers, and another one comes in and conquers, and another one comes in and conquers, and they're never independent. Remember we said last week that Herod wasn't a Jewish king. He was put on the throne by Caesar. He's ruling in the name of Caesar. And the Pharisees, they look at this, and they wonder, why has God not set us free? God said he wants to be our king. Why is he allowing other people to be our king? Why is God not coming and manifesting himself and manifesting his reign and giving us the liberty that he's promised? And the answer that they came up with, the Pharisees believed that the reason why God had not intervened and set them free was because people weren't keeping the law. And so they said, what we need to do, and they started this about 100 years before Jesus, what we need to do is to teach people the law and teach people to follow the law. And as soon as everybody gets it right, God will come in and set us free, and we'll have our land, we'll have our kingdom back. So for the Pharisees, the law is really important, but it's not just kind of the law as a whole, but it's each law. They want the Jews to follow each law. It's not that nobody was keeping any of the laws. Everybody was keeping some of them, but nobody was keeping all of them. And so they're insisting that people learn to keep all of the laws, every individual law. That was their opinion. There were other opinions going on, floating around in the city of Jerusalem at the time of Jesus. We kind of heard this a little bit last week with the Sadducees and with the Herodians. For them, they look at the situation with Rome, and they know that things are kind of tense. Things are kind of hanging by a wire a little bit. And they know that if they do the wrong thing, well, then Rome is going to come and destroy them, because that's what Rome did. Rome never had a very big army. They never had the most powerful army. They had the swiftest army. And they could get from one part of the empire to another very, very quickly. And so if there was a problem, they just sent in the troops from one part of the empire. They would come in, they would destroy those people, totally destroy their cities and their walls and their customs and everything. And everything was gone. And then they would leave and go do the same to the next offenders. And it worked really well. And the Jews don't want that to happen to them. And so they're constantly asking the question, how can we be faithful to God and not offend Rome? And maybe there's some things that aren't so important in the law that we can let slide so as to not offend Rome. And so others, not the Pharisees, others would kind of ask that question, what's really important and what isn't important? What's worth risking our lives over? Because we don't want to, you know, if it comes down to, abandoning God or losing our life, we'll lose our lives. But we don't want to lose our lives for something that's not really important. So what's the most important thing in the law? Right, so the Pharisees, they know that kind of these two opinions are floating around. And you know, we'll see that second opinion during the trial of Jesus, when the high priest says, you know, it's better for one man to lose his life than for all of us to lose our nation and the temple, right? So they're willing to do something that they know is wrong to Jesus in order to prevent Rome from coming in and destroying them, right? So that's another attitude. And so the Pharisees now, they approach Jesus and they ask him his opinion. Now this is just like the questions that have come before. This is kind of a question with no answer, with no right answer. Maybe today the best, in our time, the best comparison, if you remember in the last election cycle, the Black Lives Matter movement was really powerful and really influential. And so you'd see town halls or debates, and someone a candidate would be asked the question, do Black Lives Matter? And you know, candidates, they really struggle with that, because there was no right answer. Politically, there was no right answer. You know, you've got some people who believe that all lives are equal, and that's what we ought to say. And if you say that one group matters and you don't say the same thing about everybody else, then you're kind of putting everybody else down. You've got others who say, well, you know, but blacks have experienced some unique injustices, and those need to be accounted for. Those need to be made up for. And the candidate is left to choose, all right, which group of these people am I going to offend, right? There's no right answer. They've got to reject half of their constituency in order to answer that question with a simple yes, no answer. And that's what the Pharisees are asking Jesus to do. Jesus, are you going to side with us? Are you going to say that the whole law is important and that people need to keep each and every law? Or are you going to side with those people who are kind of watering down the law in order to not get in trouble with Rome? Are you going to side with those who bow down to Rome rather than siding with us who are faithful to the law? Well, Jesus, as we've seen in the past, is able to escape every trap. And he's able to escape every trap because of how well he knows and understands the law, because it comes from his own heart. And he quotes two passages. So let's look at where he quotes. He first quotes Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, the book of Deuteronomy, this is Moses. He's at the end of his life, and he's getting ready to kind of hand on the baton to Joshua, who will be the leader of the Israelites after Moses dies. And so he's recounting to the Israelites, as they're traveling through the desert, everything that God has done. And here in chapter 6, he gives this big kind of summary statement, and he puts it into perspective. And Moses intends this to be kind of just a statement that captures the whole law. And so he says, he gives a little a statement about how there's one God, which Matthew leaves out and Jesus leaves out here. But then in verse 6, he says, in verse 5, he says, "Therefore, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." And the Jews, they understood that this one law, not at the time of Jesus, later on, Jews would understand that this one law really captured the whole law and summarized the whole law. And so, the book of Deuteronomy says, drill them into your children, speak of them at home and abroad, whether you're busy or at rest, bind them at your wrist as a sign and let them be a pendant on your forehead, write them on the doorposts of your houses and on your gates. And there are some Jewish sects that even they'll write that law on a little scroll, and they'll put it either in like a band around their wrist or in a little box that they strap onto their foreheads. A lot of times on Jewish houses, you'll see it on the doorpost as you walk in, that law written there, because it says to write it on your doorpost, to be constantly reminded of this. But Moses understood that was something that was intended to capture the whole law. The problem with it is that it seems that someone can fulfill their religious obligations without, you know, their obligations to God, without fulfilling their obligations to everybody else, and that would be okay, because it just says, love God. Jesus, however, understands that's not true, and that understanding of the law is dangerous. In fact, that's kind of what the way the Pharisees tend to do things. They keep the law without having a love for their neighbor. And so Jesus attaches to it another law, one that he finds in the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, verse 18. And there he says that you shall not bear hatred for your brother in your heart, though you may have to reprove your fellow man, nor incur sin because of him. Take no revenge and cherish no grudge against your fellow countrymen. And then here's the part that he quotes, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Right, so Jesus attaches this second law to that first law, says that they go together. And this, when the Pharisees hear this, it just silences them. It rings so true. They realize that it kind of does capture the whole law, and they can't think of another law that would not be fulfilled if someone was just doing those two things. And so they walk away in silence, or actually they stop questioning. They don't walk away yet. They will after the next passage. Jesus puts these two things together. You know, whenever we do the right thing, we are loving both God and neighbor. However, that isn't always seen. You know, we can think of examples when we're like doing something that shows our love for God, and we can think of other examples when we're doing something that shows our love for our neighbor. But Jesus understands that they go together. That if someone is doing one, they're also doing the other. And as Jesus does this, as Jesus answers this question, he shows something about himself and the way that he understands the law. First, he's studied. And so he's able to find that statement from Moses that Moses intended to be a summary statement, right? And he's not like, setting that aside. He's not saying Moses didn't get it or the book of Deuteronomy was wrong, right? He just embraces what's there in Scripture, because sometimes Scripture really kind of interprets itself. But sometimes Scripture is hard to interpret. Sometimes there are things in Scripture that the book itself doesn't give a whole lot of attention to, but that's really important. And that's an example of what we see in the book of Leviticus. But Jesus, even though there's nothing in the text that highlights it, it's just kind of in a list of a bunch of fairly random things that the book wants people to know about. It's just kind of in the middle of that list. But Jesus is able to recognize how important it is, because Scripture itself comes from the heart of God, and Jesus, he knows the heart of God. He comes from the heart of God. And so in his study, when he was reading it, immediately he said, that rings true. That's what's in my heart. That's what God wants of us. And even though the text itself didn't kind of lend weight to it, Jesus realizes that it's true, and Jesus is able to give us that definitive interpretation of sacred Scripture. All right, so take these things to mind as you discuss the questions that are in your handouts, and hopefully this will help you to understand the passage a little bit better, and especially to be able to put it into practice in your lives. God bless.